If you have your Bible, please turn to Luke's Gospel, chapter 17. Luke's Gospel, chapter 17. This is going to be an overview of some of the things of Scripture. And the title for tonight's message is, So You're Looking for a Sign. So You're Looking for a Sign. How many people say, I'd get saved if God just gave me a sign? How many say, I would give my life to Christ and surrender myself if God would just give me a sign? We know every time you turn on your news, every time you hear the radio news, and better still, if you were to read your Bible, you would see signs all over it that Christ is near, even at the door. And He's given you a sign to get ready, a sign to be saved, a sign to get right with Him. So bear with me tonight, for I'm going to bring you somewhere. You might think, well, what has this got to do with His second coming? But please bear with me. Let's read Luke 17, and we'll just start reading from verse 20. Luke 17 and verse 20. And when He was demanded of the Pharisees, when the kingdom of God should come, He answered them and said, The kingdom of God cometh not with observation. Neither shall they say, Lo here or Lo there, for behold, the kingdom of God is within you. And He said unto the disciples, The days will come when ye shall desire to see one of the days of the Son of Man, and ye shall not see it. And they shall say unto you, See here or see there. Go not after them, nor follow them. For as the lightning that lighteneth out of the one part under the heaven shineth unto the other part under heaven, so shall also the Son of Man be in His day. But first must He suffer many things and be rejected of this generation. Now keep your Bible open there, for we're going to really look at this chapter quite extensively, but you're going to need to mark it, for we're going other places also. Let's just pray. Father, we ask You that You would settle every heart now. We thank You, Lord, for the testimony of Your saving grace. We thank You, Lord, for what we have heard tonight. Now, Lord, we ask You, Lord, that You would open up the Scriptures to us. Lord, that You would fill my mouth and hide me. Lord, we don't want to see a preacher, but we want to hear the voice of God. And we want to see Your Son alone, none other. Help us, Father. Lord, we thank You as we wait upon Your Spirit. And as we wait upon Your anointing just to fall upon us. We thank You, Lord, in the quietness of this. You would tell us it's not by might, nor by power. By My Spirit, saith the Lord of hosts. We thank You, Lord, that Your anointing is promised to us. And so we claim that in Jesus' name. Save souls. Restore backsliders. Strengthen Your children. Glorify Your Son. We ask it for Jesus' name's sake. Amen. The Lord Jesus is asked in our opening verse, verse 20. Notice the Pharisees ask Him when the kingdom of God should come. Notice this also, His own disciples ask Him at His resurrection. And you see, it's always something in the minds of people, when is the kingdom of God going to come? And men debate it through theology, and I might have a theology of how He will come, or when we think the order of things will be as He comes, but we're not looking at that tonight. And you may have yours, you may have something different, but rather what we're looking at is the certainty that Christ is coming. And whenever they ask Him, notice, He asked him when the kingdom of God should come. He answered them and said, "The kingdom of God cometh not with observation." Underline the word observation. Mark it in your Bible, because that's important. You want to look at it first before we go any further. In Matthew 24 and verse 42, the Lord Jesus tells us, notice, "Watch therefore, for you know not when, what hour, pardon me, you know not what hour your Lord doth come." Now notice, "you know not what hour your Lord doth come." In Matthew 25 and verse 13, he says, "Watch therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour wherein the Son of Man cometh." Notice, your Lord comes, the Son of Man cometh. This tells me Christ is speaking of himself and his return. It's telling us that he is Lord and that he is coming again. Then when we go again to the scriptures, to Mark's Gospel, chapter 13 and verse 35, the Lord Jesus says again, "Watch ye therefore, for you know not when the master of the house cometh, at even, or at midnight, or at cockcrowing, or in the morning." So now he's the master. He's the Lord, the Son of Man. He's the master, and he's coming. The thing is, we don't know when. And then in Luke chapter 21 and in verse 36, he says again, "Watch ye therefore, and pray always, that ye may be accounted worthy to escape all these things that shall come to pass." Notice, "and to stand before the Son of Man." So he says, "I'm coming again." The Lord's coming, who is the Son of Man. The Master's coming, and we don't know when. And we will stand before him, the risen Christ, the Son of Man glorified, the Son of God. So take note, Matthew 24, the Lord comes, the Son of Man comes. He's coming unexpectedly, and every one of us will stand before him. So the Lord says, since he's coming, you must be ready to stand before him. I'm speaking to someone tonight, and you're not ready. What if something happened tonight before his coming? You'll stand before him. And the state you die in is the state you will stand in. And the state you stand in is the state you will be judged in, just as Richard had read out, breaking the law and his commandments. And you're not ready. You're not saved. You haven't been to the cross, and you're not trusting in the blood that he shed. You haven't given your life over completely and wholly to Jesus now. And you'll stand before him. But at his coming, every man and every woman, to some degree, will stand before him. We're going to look at it briefly. First of all, every believer. Let's just talk about the believers for a moment. Every believer will stand before the Lord Jesus Christ and give an account. In Romans 14 and 10, and in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 10, we'll read the latter scripture. Listen to what Paul says. "For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that everyone may receive the things done in his body, according to that he hath done, whether it be good or bad." Paul is saying this to the Corinthian church. He's saying it to the blood-washed. He's saying it to the child of God. He's saying it to the believer. He says, child of God, every single one of us, listen, including himself, the apostle who has given us through inspiration of the Spirit of God, almost 2/3 of the New Testament, has told us that every one of us as Christians will stand before the judgment seat of Christ. Now, take note, Christian, this is not the great white throne judgment. This is what's known as the Bema seat. They had games like Roman games, or they had Greek games, and they came, and the winners came. It's like we would have the Olympic games, first, second, and third, where we receive reward or maybe even loss. But every single one of us will stand before him as a believer. And your life as a Christian, my life as a Christian, your life as a child of God, your service, how you walked before Him, what you did before Him, how you reached out to others for His kingdom with the gifts, as it were, and the talents that He has gifted you with and given to you. And we will stand for reward or loss. We'll all stand before Him. And I remember one time a young preacher saying at the Bema seat, "Lord, there'll be many Bemers at the Bema seat. There'll be embarrassment there from many people who has professed the name of Christ. There will be embarrassment there from people who have said, 'Oh yes, I'm saved by grace.' But the things, the gifts, the talents, and the abilities, the desires of heart have changed as life has went on, and we find ourselves drifted away from God, maybe even backslidden in heart and not getting on with Him. We'll all stand according to the Scripture. Secondly, this is for me. This is for Ronnie, who'll be preaching at the weekend. This is for leaders. This is for elders. This is for pastors. This is for your minister. This is for all of us. Hebrews 13:7 says, "To you first, obey them which have the rule over you and submit yourselves. For they watch for your souls, as they must give an account." You see, I remember one time a young woman said to me, "Pastor, why are you always on? Come out on a Sunday night, be out at your Bible study, you're around at the house if we're not there. You're on the phone, you're always trying to G us up and push us on." And I says, "Because I'm watching for your soul. And what I preach, I'll give an account. And listen, what we don't preach the gospel. We don't preach the book. We don't preach the blood. If we don't tell you your need of salvation, we will stand as ministers before you. And there's going to be men who are standing before God, ashamed with blood on their skirts, because they never told the people the truth, because they're afraid of what the congregation will say. While others have slipped into a lost eternity, the point of death. God forgive them." We will stand and give an account. I will stand and give an account of what I teach you, what I tell you, how I shepherd my flock. And I will give an account, and maybe they'll be beside me. I don't know how it's going to work. Maybe one will come up at a time. Maybe one's a should have witnessed to, or I didn't witness to, or maybe one's a should have preached that more, or whatever. I don't know what way it will work. But I know this, I will give an account. Ronnie, you will give an account when you're out on Sunday night. There's others in here who maybe be speaking or preaching. You will give an account, friend. See, I'm conscious of it. People say you get too excited, or you get too wound up, and you're too enthusiastic. I can tell you something, friend. I'm too conscious that I will stand before God and give an account for what I have or haven't said. That's why. So the believer, every one of us will stand and give an account. The leader will stand and give an account, or the minister. And thirdly, quickly, the unbeliever. Every unbeliever. Is that you? But here's your account if you don't know Christ. Revelation chapter 20, if you want to flick over quickly with me, please. Here is the account of the Christ rejector. I trust there's no Christ rejectors tonight in this place. Here is the account of those who do not know Christ as their Savior. Here is the account of those who have turned Him away and walked out of the mission night after night and says, I'll hear another time, and die in that condition, or Christ comes back in that condition. Revelation chapter 20, we haven't time to read much of it, but let's just look at a few verses. Starting to read from verse 11, John says, "And I saw a great white throne and Him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were open, and another book was open, which is the book of life, and the dead were judged out of the things that were written in the books according to their works. In other words, did they receive him? Did they believe him? Did they accept Christ? And this is the great white throne judgment of God. The resurrection of the dead are in the next verse, notice. And the sea give up the dead which were in it. And death and hell, or the grave, the region of the dead, give up, delivered up the dead which were in them. And they were judged, every man according to their works. And death and hell, that is the grave, were cast into the lake of fire. And this is the second death. That's the unbeliever. That's the unbeliever. Is that you, friend? For here's your destined end, as according to the word of God. So, verse 15 says, and whosoever, Ronnie prayed for the whosoever, we've mentioned the whosoever. Whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. Friend, you see, whenever we go back again to our opening chapter of Luke 17, these Pharisees say that Jesus, these religious Jewish leaders, they say to Jesus, when is the kingdom of God going to come? Notice his answer. The kingdom of God cometh not with observation. What does he mean? He's told us to watch. He's told us to watch. He's told us to watch ye therefore, and he's told us to watch and pray always. We're going to stand before you. Now, if we can't see it coming, he says, how are we going to know? This is what he means. The word observation is it's a big, long Greek word. We'll not even try and pronounce it. It's like paratereisis or something like that. And this is what it means. You'll not see it, he says. You'll not see the kingdom of God coming by ocular vision, it's called, by your eyeballs, in other words. You will not see it by even attentive watching. It does not come that it can be watched with the naked eye. Do you know what this means? Do you say, man, well, what are we watching for? Stay with me. The kingdom of God comes, if I can call it, three stages. If I can call it that. First of all, spiritual stage. Secondly, dominial stage. Thirdly, the literal stage. First of all, spiritual means you're saved. Secondly, dominial means you're sanctified. And thirdly, literal means the kingdom is coming in fullness. Or, spiritually saved is kingdom rule in your life and in your heart. Christ is your Savior. Dominion means you're sanctified and you're kingdom living. You're living for Christ. And thirdly, literal is the second coming of the literal kingdom when we pray, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And at the coming of Christ is the literal kingdom. And what Jesus is saying, you can't see the kingdom unless you're born again. In John chapter 3 and verse 3, Nicodemus comes to him by night. And he says that the Lord says to him, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. If you're not born again or born from above, and the word means you can't know how it works. You can't tell it, you can't perceive it, nor can you see it with the eyes or any other senses. And what he's saying is, unless the Holy Spirit moves on you, unless the Holy Ghost speaks to you, unless the Holy Ghost quickens you and makes your dead spirit alive unto God. Richard said he was hard. He didn't want to know. He was hard. He couldn't receive the things of God. And people were telling him about the things of God. He was hearing preaching about the things of God, testimonies about the things of God. But he was hard. One day, suddenly, what did he do? He said, he done this. The Holy Ghost came. started showing him. See, that's what Christ is all about. Listen, see if you sense that tug of the Holy Spirit. But I can't see. You know, it's like the illustration of the wee boy in the windy day. And he lets his kite out and the kite goes way up and he's holding on to it and the clouds are lowering. And the kite's in the clouds and you can't see the kite. And a man comes along and there's his wee handle and the string going up to heaven. And he's doing this. And the man's looking and sees nothing but the string and looks at the boy and sees nothing but the string. He says, son, what are you doing? He says, I'm flying my kite. He says, but son, you can't see the kite. You can't see it. How do you know it's there? And the wee boy says, I know it's there because I can feel the tug. I can feel the tug. How do I know it's God? You'll know it's God because you'll feel the tug. You'll feel the tug. You see, the Lord Jesus meant the kingdom of God is within you, or it also means the kingdom of God is in the midst of you, among you. Do you know why it was in the midst and among them? Because the king was standing in the middle of them. Jesus himself. Jesus himself. Can we tell when the second coming is? I believe so. We don't know the day or the hour. Can we tell when this judgment seat is close? Yep, I believe so. When the king is coming? Yes, I believe so. It says in Matthew 16, verses 1 to 3. Listen to this. The Lord Jesus says, it says, the Pharisees also with the Sadducees came tempting, desired that he, that is the Lord Jesus, would show them a sign. So you're looking for a sign. That's the message tonight. You're looking for a sign. They're saying, show us a sign. And they desired that he would show them a sign. Verse 2, and he answered and said unto them, when it is evening, you say, it will be fair weather, for the sky is red. And in the morning it will be foul weather today, for the sky is red and lowering. Oh, ye hypocrites, ye can discern the face of the sky, but ye cannot discern the signs of the times. Do you know what Jesus is saying? He's saying, you know, you go out into the fields and you're farmers. You go out and you sow crops and you know what time of the year it is and you know when they expect the rains or well, it's too much for you. You just know all about it, he says. You can tell what the sky is like and what the weather's going to be like. He says, yet the king is in your midst. The one who's been prophesied of from Genesis chapter 3 and verse 15 at the fall in the garden. To him give all the prophets witness, and you can discern it all, and you know it all. He says, but now I'm standing right in front of you. He says, you're a hypocrite. You can't even see it. Friends, God speaks to you, and he's saying, you can't even discern with the signs that are happening that I'm coming. Surely this world cannot continue. Surely it cannot continue in the way it has been continuing on. So looking for a sign, we're going to flash through some signs. Every one of these deserve a night on their own. But here's just snapshots of signs that the Lord has told us about. Luke 17 again. In verse 26. Luke 17, verse 26, the Lord says, and as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it also be in the days of the Son of Man. They did eat, they drank, they married wives, they were given in marriage until the day that Noah entered into the ark, and the flood came and destroyed them all. Likewise also as it is in the days of Lot. So he starts to give us signs here. He says, when I return, this Son of Man, this Lord, this Master, when I return, he says, here's your sign. It's going to be like it was in the days of Noah. Now, we haven't time to read it, but especially you go when you read Genesis chapter 6 before the flood. And when you read Genesis 6, let's just read a few verses that we get the theme of it, the feel of it. I'm conscious that time is motoring. Genesis chapter 6. And let your eye run down to verse 5. And God saw the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. Now notice this. In verse 1, there's an explosion of population. Men began to multiply on the face of the earth, and daughters were born unto them. Explosion of population. It gets worse when there's an explosion of population, then they start bringing all their fanciful ideas and all of their gods, and they mix and mingle together. So that's one of the signs. We're seeing the explosion population today. We're seeing the mixing and the mingling where gods are being brought into our very land and our nation that our land was never used to hear of. And everything's fine with it. Secondly, in verse 2, sexual perversion. And the sons of God saw that the daughters of men were fair, and they took them wives, all of which they chose. They chose them. They took them at will. That means there was sexual, demonic perversion. We see it everywhere today. Demonic perversion in our land. Demonic perversion in the United Kingdom. Demonic perversion all over Ireland. Sexual perversion. And thirdly, in verse 5, then, we have the constant evil in the heart of men. Good news doesn't carry anymore. Good news doesn't ring home to hearts anymore. We don't want to hear good news, but rather we'd rather hear the bad news, for that's what sells. The bad news that someone has been murdered. The bad news that someone's got up the drug abuse, or someone has died, or something has happened. Or the bad news, there's been explosions, and there's been gun battles. The bad news, there's been beheadings. Bad news, everybody tunes in. Between rapists and pedophiles and murderers. Did he hear the news? Do you hear the news? Have you heard of this and you heard of that? Scandals in government and all of these things. It's bad news. And their hearts are evil continually before God. And God says, I am going to judge this people. I'm going to move and judge this people. Fourthly, in verse 11, let's run down for time's sake. It says, the earth was also corrupt before God, and the earth was filled with violence. Well, we don't need to explain that, do we? Every continent. There's hardly a country in the world now that isn't touched with terrorist violence. We know what that's like in little Ulster. We know what that's like in the UK. America, until 9/11, had never had a great attack on their own homeland. And now that boundary has been broken. We think of France and Spain and Germany and Sweden. We think of all of these countries. We think of what's going on in Africa and in the Asia. We think of the drug barons and drug lords of Mexico and all the South Americas. We think of the violence and the hurt and the anguish of the people. Just like in the days of Noah, God said. Says they're corrupt. God looked, it says. Verse 12, and God looked upon the earth, and behold, it was corrupt, for all flesh had corrupted his way upon the earth. See the words God looked? It means God looked intently. Now, God sees everything, but the idea is for you and I to understand just what God thinks of it. It's like God sees it all. It's like I see all of you, but it's like then suddenly I just come right in. God looked at it. God looked, he says, it was corrupted. The word corrupt means had gone to ruin, perverted and marred. Look up the words. The word corrupted here means they had gone to ruin, become perverted, and they were marred. Looking for a sign? Are you looking for a sign? Read that then. Look out your window. And the Lord Jesus says, as it were in the days of Noah, he says, the sign is this. It'll happen in the earth. Turn on your news. Lift up the paper. Turn on the radio at whatever station it is. Listen to it and say, Jesus is coming soon. The Lord also mentions in our chapter Luke 17, Notice what he says here. Letting your eye run down to verse 28. Likewise also as it was in the days of Lot, they did eat, they drank, they bought, they sold, they planted, they builded. But the same day that Lot went out of Sodom, it rained fire and brimstone from heaven and destroyed them all. Even thus shall it be in the day when the Son of Man is revealed. Jesus said that. You see what it was like in the days of Noah? Well, here's another sign. It'll be like it was in the days of Lot. Well, how do we know what it was like? We go back to Genesis. We haven't time to read it. But if you go home tonight and you open up Genesis chapter 18 and into 19 and so on, you'll read about Abraham and Lot, and you'll read about the Lord coming down for all the wickedness of Sodom and of Gomorrah. But notice what it says in verse 27 and 28. It says they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage. In verse 28, they were doing something similar. They bought and they sold. In other words, life was going on. Life was actually being pretty good, maybe even prosperous. But they had no care nor thought of God, and they lived in their wicked ways. You just look at our nation. You just look at what's happening around us. And you tell us. You tell yourself and be honest with yourself and before God. Every time you see it. And every time you hear it. Do you not look at it and you can see with those eyes? Can you perceive it? And if you can, then it's the tug of the Spirit. To see the wickedness. To see how far our nation has fallen. Evangelical Ulster. Little evangelical Ulster. Become a cesspit. Become a cesspit. We need to have eyes to see. Lord, help us. Help us to see what is happening in our land, in our families. The standard even of living. I'm not talking about money. I'm talking about the things that are allowed to be put on programs. You want to be careful because there's also children here, but things that you see even on the ordinary programs you would watch. Things that would never have been on are now acceptable. They've become like the Catholic Church calls them venial sins. You know, the little sins that really don't matter too much. But when you get those little venial sins, and sin is sin is sin before the eyes of God, and when you get the little venial sin that doesn't matter too much, you know what happens? You push it to the side and a bigger sin comes in until it becomes venial. And then that is washed over, and a greater sin until it becomes venial. Until you're in the world like Richard. Until you're living it up and you're clubbing it up, and remember, you're having all sorts of things going on in your life. And then the depravity of man kicks in, that there's nothing that would shock me anymore. And we can live it up to the vilest of our own humanity. We become gods of our own selves. We worship the creature rather than the creator, as Paul says. We worship ourselves. That's where we are. You're worshiping yourself. Man worships himself rather than worshiping God. I talked to someone last night after the meeting. You know what I told them? One of the things I told them, do you know what's wrong with you? You worship yourself. You love yourself more than you love God. And that's why you are the way you are. And they cried like a baby. You're looking for a sign. Open your window. Abraham pleads with the angels that come down with the Lord, and two angels says, if there be 50 righteous in Sodom, don't destroy it. And he goes right down pleading, I won't destroy for 50. He goes right down to 10. If you can find 10, Lord, in the Sodom, please don't destroy it. The Lord says, if I find 10, you know what? He hardly found a one. Only Peter happens to mention, righteous Lot vexed his filthy soul with the conversations or the lifestyle of the wicked. I don't know how Lot was righteous, but all I know was if the Bible says he was, I'll have to accept it. But nevertheless, he lived in their midst. One. Oh, he brought his daughters out, but look at what happened to them. They committed incest with their father. They're only out of it. That was the sin. That's how things went. Do you realize now, in the news, it's been saying that there's now a father who wants to become the daughter, and the daughter who wants to become the father. And they're dressing like that. As it was in the days of Noah, as it was in the days of Lot. And Jesus says, "Hey, when you see it, he says, I'm coming. The Lord's coming. The Son of Man's coming. The Master's on his way." The Lord said he saw the sin was great. If you want to jot it down, Genesis 18 and 20, he says, "Their sin is very grievous to me." Do you ever think of how grievous we are before God? Grieving him. Holiness. And so we're told in Luke 17 and 30, "Even thus shall it be when the Son of Man is revealed, when he breaks the clouds and comes, such will be the world we live in." So you're looking for a sign. Quickly, we'll read these for another couple of signs. Luke chapter 21. Here's another sign for you, a couple of signs for you. Luke 21. Let your eye run down to verse 9. The Lord Jesus says, "But when you shall hear of wars and commotions, be not terrified, for these things must come to pass, and the end is not by and by. Then said he unto them, Nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. There shall be great earthquakes, there shall be in divers places, and famines, and pestilences, and fearful sights, and great signs shall there be from heaven." Notice what the Lord is saying here. There's going to be upheaval of nations. I could go through this, and we just take time's gone, you can afford me, I'm sure it's a Friday night, you can afford me another 10 minutes, will you? Listen. Russia. Iran. Bashar al-Assad. Bashar Hussein al-Assad from Syria. They're all in line with each other, and Ezekiel 37 tells us about these nations. Russian warships just off the coast of a big port there, off the coast of Syria. Hezbollah is joined with them in Lebanon. We see all the saber rattling happening. The European Union, there's troops. Did you know there was 40 new American tanks went in to the far eastern part against Russia in the last couple of weeks? Do you know, it has been on the news as far as I've seen it, that there was 400 British troops put along the front line recently in Europe against Russia? Revelation chapter 16 tells us that the great river Euphrates is dried up, and that's another story for another time, but it says to prepare the way for the kings of the east. They're starting to launch their missiles, the kings of the rising sun, in North Korea, in China. The great communist dragon is rising as a power in the earth, and now they've moved right down into the South Pacific. They're talking about invading around Taiwan and into the Philippines. America now says, "Well, we'll go after you," and they're sending their war fleets over as we speak. They're talking about coming to the north of Australia. And America and I are building one of the biggest seaports in northern Australia to house their warships. Nations shall rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. You're looking for a sign? Are you looking for a sign and you're not saved? I could go on and on. Talk about the Karakoram Highway. Runs right through Pakistan and out, and the Chinese can use it to run right towards the land of Israel. Karakoram Highway runs the whole way through there, built there. Talk about the great Gwadara seaport off Iran's coast. One of the biggest seaports in the world now, and it's being manned by China. They've also bought up half of the coast around of the north of the South America region. And they're now transporting billions of barrels of oil, saying to buy of the oil, to start an oil war with the United States. We could go on and on and on, and the pot is bubbling. Racial tension has risen. We see the influx of illegal immigration and terrorism all over Europe. And the Lord says, when you see it come to pass, he says, know that I'm coming. Oh, I wish you would come tonight, Lord, and sort it all out. You're looking for a sign. There's a sign. He's knocking at your door. Luke 21, verse 29. Here's a sign. Luke 21, verse 29. He spake unto them a parable. Behold, the fig tree and all the trees where they now shoot forth. You see, I know of your own selves the summer is nigh at hand. So likewise, when you see these things come to pass, know ye that the kingdom of God is at hand. Here it comes in its literal form, we told you. Coming to be set up in the earth at the coming of Christ. Verily I say unto you, this generation shall not pass away till all things be fulfilled. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word shall not pass away. Jesus says, you hear my word and heed it. You know what the fig tree is? The fig tree represented the southern kingdom of Israel, which were the Judah, or the Jews as it's known, where you get the name Jews. And the Jews in Israel are the fig tree nation. The Jews who are in the Israelite state right now are the fig tree nation that became nationhood in 1948. And Jesus says, whether you're for them or against them, you like them or they love them, it doesn't matter. He says they'll be there. And this is what he says. You're looking for a sign? This will be a sign. Are you saved? Let's go back to Luke 17 as we close this. Thank you for your attention and for allowing me to run over a bit tonight. Luke 17, the Lord Jesus gives us a sign. This is the greatest sign. Luke 17, verse 24 says, for as the lightning that lighteneth out of the one part of heaven shineth unto the other part under heaven, so shall also the Son of Man be in his day. Is that the greatest sign ever? Huh. That's the greatest sign that's to come. The greatest sign is the next verse. But first he must suffer many things and be rejected of this generation. What do you mean, Jesus? Well, he's given us another sign. But first, he says, you'll see me hanging a cross. He says, you don't look for the second coming. You don't want the second coming, friend. You don't want to be praying, Lord, come even now, because this is a terrible world. He says, first you must see the great sign of the cross. Listen to what he says in Matthew 12 and verse 40. For as Jonah was 3 days and 3 nights in the whale's belly, so also shall the Son of Man be 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth. They asked him for a sign. He says, a wicked and adulterous generation seeketh after a sign. You want a sign? He says, the Son of Man will be 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth as Jonah was in the whale's belly. And he says here, I'm going to be rejected of these men. I'm going to be crucified. And it must first happen. It must first come to pass before my coming and all these other signs. You know why? Because if he doesn't go to the cross, you and I will stand before him. And the second death is the lake of fire from Revelation 20. And Jesus says, oh, you know, he could say it would be easy. I just go and I could end up, Father, take me back into heaven. I just want to go back to be with you. If Christ wanted to give up then, he could have, but he never. He says here, but I'm going to suffer many things, be rejected by everybody. Friend, he suffered many things for you. Richard quoted, confess him before men, that he'll confess you before his Father in heaven. He suffered for me. He suffered that we would be saved. He suffered that when it comes, the lightning that shines from the east to the west under the heaven, when the whole heavens are filled with its glory at his coming, that those who know him, love him, are trusting in him, are born again, or born from above. You know what Jesus said? Said the man be born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. Born of water and the Spirit means accept a man or a woman. Accept you're born from above. You know what Jesus said? I am from above. And I've come down. If you're not born into me, when I come down, he says, you'll not go above. He says, you'll not be in the kingdom. So I'll suffer for you. I'll bleed and die for you. That you can be where I am. That you can be saved. Before I return. Friend, are you saved? You looking for a sign? There's a few of them. There's many others. What more do you need? Sign of the cross. I'm not talking about this sign like that. I'm talking about the cross on which he died. I'm talking about the cross where he shed his blood. I'm talking about the cross where he gave his life. I'm talking about the cross where he went through much sorrow and suffered many things that you would be saved. That you would be in the kingdom. That his Spirit, you feel the tug and you start to realize my need of him. My need of him. Salvation is off the